We're in the midst of editing a multi-part episode with Mark Solms, the author of The Hidden Spring, A Journey to the Source of Consciousness. I wanted to share a little teaser of that episode. This is about the importance of play and how all mammals play because we learn from play. Those of you who have children, you know the way most episodes end in tears. There's a reason behind that, and Mark will explain why.
We human beings, but not only us, in fact, all mammals need to play. It's a need. And you know, and that really surprises people because you can see why lust is important biologically, you know, and rage and fear and et cetera, attachment bonding. But play, you know, play by definition, it's not even real. It's play. You know, so how can that be important biologically? And so again, I don't want to give the impression that we know everything there is to know about play. But I'll tell you some of the things we've learned about it. First of all, which I've more or less said already, all mammals play. You know, a good example, again, since you mentioned dogs in open fields, you know, a good example is you go to a park, look at what the dogs do. You know, what they do is they play. And so the kids are also playing, you know, but let's talk about the dogs. The one invites the other one to play. And the way that they do it is that they put their front legs low on the ground, they put their backsides in the air, jump around a little bit, and then run. And that means, do you want to play? The one who's been invited, if they accept the invitation, they chase the one who has invited them. And then they do this rough and tumble thing, you know, and they clearly love it. And then they turn around, and the one who was being chased now becomes the chaser. And they chase each other around and jump on top of each other. And that's what they do. And mice do it. Rats do it. Cats do it. All mammals do it. There are obviously variations depending on what, like, I mean, whales play, dolphins play, elephants play. Obviously, they don't run around doing rough and tumble, but they do the equivalent, you know, within their anatomical phenotype. So this thing, we study play. I mean, it's remarkable that, you know, rough and tumble play, kids, little mammals do it. Why is the question? You ask a human being, you know, a human kid, what's your favorite thing to do in the world? And they say, play, you know. Then you say, why? They say, because it's fun. And then you say, why is it fun? You know, they don't know why it's fun. It's just because it is. But that's the scientific question. You know, why is this odd activity such fun? Now, I told you it's their favorite thing to do. But when you study play empirically, the first thing you learn is that most play episodes end in tears. So that's a remarkable fact. And then we studied, when I say we, I mean my colleagues in my field. I mean, not all of this is me or my team, but those of us who study this remarkable thing, what we observe is, what we try to understand is, why does it end in tears? In other words, what is it that leads to the end of the fun? And what we learned from that was what's called the 60-40 rule. Again, it's an incredibly robust rule, although we call it 60-40. It's really between 60 or 70 on the one hand and 30 and 40 on the other hand. And this ratio refers to the fact that in play, one is doing the chasing, the other one is being chased. One is on top, the other one is underneath. And the one who's underneath or who's being chased, it's fun for them too. We call them the submissive playmate. So there's a dominant one and a submissive one, and they both have fun as long as the one who's dominant doesn't dominate too much. So if you, the chaser or the one who's on top, and you want to be so more than 60 or 70% of the time, then for the submissive playmate, it's no longer fun. And then they say, I'm not going to play with you anymore. You're not being fair, you know, and that word fairness. Is crucially important. So this 60-40 rule is about fairness. It's about turn taking. It's about reciprocity. So if I can, I don't want to be too abstract. So let me link it to human games. I mean, think of, in our culture, by which I mean, you know, sort of Western culture, the game, common games are cops and robbers, or doctor and patient, or mommy and baby, or teacher and pupil. In all of them, you see the hierarchy. And so the one little girl says, you know, let's play teacher. And the other little girl says, okay. You know, and then the one who's initiated the game says, you're the pupil, I'm the teacher. Okay, you know, okay, now you've got to do this, now you've got to do that. I'm the teacher, bossing the pupil around. Fun for a while, but eventually it's like, okay, when do I get to be the teacher? You know, or when do I get to call the shots and let's play another game? Let's play mommy baby, and you're the baby and I'm the mommy. You know, then it's fun if you take turns like that. So that's the 60-40 rule. From studying that, we realize that play has everything to do with dominance. It has to do with establishing a hierarchy. And we mammals are a social species. Mammals always live in groups. And I'm sorry to say this. This is not an ideological statement. I'm not saying it should be like this. I'm saying it is like this. I'm sorry to say mammal groups are hierarchical. There's, you know, somebody's at the top, and then there's a pecking order below that, and it's through play that the pecking order is established, and this is what we've observed. So now, if I can just pause for a moment there, think back to your early childhood days on the playing field. You know, when you first went to school, and you're a member of a group, and you got to find your place in that group. And it's a serious business, you know. If you're a top dog, that's great. If you're a nerd, nobody wants to play with you, that's dreadful. It's absolute, it feels dreadful, and it's catastrophic, you know, for your life. And I say for your life because please note, this doesn't stop, you know, at age 8 or something. You know, it generalizes, but this kind of competitive, rivalrous, you know, who's who in the zoo. Are you in? Are you out? Are you up? Are you down? Are you of high status or low status? High rank, low rank? Things like wealth and property and all of these things, you know, which are you might think not biological. They're the equivalent of what you find in other mammal societies. So let me just pause for a moment and say how the hierarchy works is the mammal group controls a territory. And the higher you are in the hierarchy, the greater access you have to the resources of the territory. So, you know, this is in this sense, it's biological. You know, the higher you are in the pecking order, the better things work for you. But because we're a social species, we live in groups, it's also important for us as a species that we have viable groups, we have stable groups, we have groups which are not attacking each other all the time. And so this 60-40 rule, which acknowledges that there's a hierarchy, it actually makes it, it's a rule. You know, it's like the beginnings of law, of social law, of what's tolerable and what's intolerable. It's sort of a setting a boundary. This is going too far. This is acceptable. And so through play, we learn what is acceptable, what's not acceptable. You know, to others. And so the 60-40 rule is saying, well, you know, okay, I accept not everyone can be top dog, but, you know, the one who's above me mustn't dominate me more than 60% of the time. I've got to have a turn. I've got to have my say. There's got to be something in it for me too. There, by the way, you know, I know that a large part of your audience are people involved in organizations. And, you know, so this is a very important thing for organizational behavior, recognizing that too steep a hierarchy, or to put it in other terms, bullying, you know, is bad. You know, to team building where everybody, you know, knows that they're part of the team and that they've got something to contribute doesn't mean they're captain. Not everyone can be the captain, you know, and this is how viable teams, viable groups are established.